For people interested in old school technology, perhaps this could be interesting. It is originally a Philips tape deck, and here are the electronics of that Philips tape deck. But I mounted it separately in a separate box because the, say, mechanical part of that recorder, cassette recorder, got weird out. And in the, say, the 70s, and especially in the 80s, for instance, Commodore, and this is the enclosure, the house of a Commodore cassette deck that was used for computer purposes to, say, load a computer program into, of course, in those days, a very simple computer. Anyway, this was the computer, originally computer tape deck, and a good property from that of that computer tape deck from Commodore was that it had a very, very good mechanical construction. They were made with gears of aluminum, sorry, aluminum, nylon. Here you can see that, the gears of nylon here. And there's only one, say, rubber band here that drives the circuit, and all the other functions, fast forward, this is fast forward, and fast backward, were made with these gears. And that proved to be a very stable and sturdy construction. And even now, 2020, this unit is from, say, 1984. Even now in 2020, this works very properly. No problem at all. I constructed this thing in, say, 15 years ago or so, and used the original Philips board with all the electronics on it. Made that in a new box, soldered together from a, say, a copper clad board. Problem is, at the moment, I tried it today, it worked properly, but I made a mistake and suddenly it stopped. So I'm gonna take it apart and repair it. But anyway, this is the standard unit that you will always find when you find on the World Wide Web or on Amazon or, say, all kinds of markets on the World Wide Web, an old Philips cassette recorder of 1962. The model was produced, as far as I know, into, say, 1974 or so. Don't know that exactly. You have to study the history of this beautiful cassette recorder anyway. But this was the print board inside, and there was a knob that had three functions: play, that was press in the forward position, fast back press in the left position, fast in the other direction to the right position, and that was all. And to record, you had to press a knob and then use the same play knob to make a record. So anyway, this is, by the way, the original speaker with that big block of magnet material. Philips was in the 1950s and 1960s one of the first factories that made these high quality magnets pressed out of, say, certain oxides of iron oxide with other materials pressed to a kind of blocks, and they had a very strong magnetic field, so the flux inside such a speaker could get very high, while at the same time the cone of the speaker could be kept very small. And in all, you had a very good combination of a high flux and not a too big cone, and so say it could reproduce a good frequency band, say between 100 hertz and 9000 hertz or so, and it was very good in those days. And also here the whole circuit of Philips. These are, by the way, the tape heads that came with the Commodore unit, but they fitted into that Philips circuit. And we see here the erase head. You can see when you look closely that it doesn't have so much windings. It's immersed, as far as I can see, in a kind of resin. It has a low impedance, say 10 ohms or 70 ohms or whatever, DC ohms, and this is the record head. And here is the slit of the record head. That's here. And there were, of course, many problems with cassette recorders. For instance, that the tape head got really magnetized. When the tape moves alongside the slit in that record head, it could be that on the longer term we got a kind of permanent magnetization, and that led to noise. So you had to erase the fixed magnetic field in such a head, say every 3 years or so. No matter, no problem. And also important to tell, the slit of that tape head has to be as small as possible to get the high frequencies properly reproduced. In the 1950s, that was a kind of problem, and I have seen magazines, electronic magazines, where they where we had instructions to make a tape head yourself, and that was always an advice to keep that slit as, say, small as possible to get to a good high frequency. Well, that were more or less all the kind of simple problems to be solved in those days with such a simple setup. Here we have the electric motor. Problem with the electric motor is always that it gives, say, all kinds of pulses on the power supply lead. Disturbing pulses that you can hear in the sound or when you record it or whatever. There are good solutions for that. I want to refer in the text box to other videos about that cassette deck. I made 3 of them in the past and solved that problem. Anyway, here is the typical Philips speed regulator of the motor, completely made by Philips. And when we look at the schematic, that's here, this is the Philips schematic of 1962 originally. Of course, it was somewhat changed in the years thereafter, say in the 70s or so, but the whole setup of that schematic was completely, say, used many years, say approximately during 10 years or so. Here we have two germanium Entel sisters, AC100 187, AC188. BC was of course a silicon transistor. Here we have the very sensitive preamplifier, and also this, and the preamplifier had the task to amplify the extremely tiny signal coming out of this playback head. Perhaps it was 3 millivolts or so, so it had to be amplified to a very substantial level to make it audible. Here we have the oscillator, the erase oscillator, the bias oscillator. It's not only to erase the tape, but also to give, while recording music or so, to give the recorded the record head a certain bias. So when you record music on such a cassette player or a tape player, there are two signals present in the record head here. The signal of the bias oscillator, that is approximately 20 kilohertz or 30 or 50 kilohertz, and the audio signal that's also sent via the amplifier here and the wiring into the record head. And at the same time, when you are recording, the erase head is active. The erase head is supplied with a very high high frequency, say 20 kHz, 30 or 50 kHz, that erases the tape when it moves alongside here, and then it comes to the record and also playback head, but the record head. So that's the way how music is recorded or was recorded. We got in the 1990s very specific materials for the playback and record head, ferrite materials. This is kind of old type of a record head. I think it's a specific type of weak iron, weak steel, where this head was made. And the material of the erase head, in my idea, is not so very important. All kinds of weak iron materials work. I talked about the speed regulation here, and you can see in the schematic that it was here, kind of secret circuit. No component values here, so you have to say, take it apart, study it for yourself. And I think it was a kind of secret inside the Philips factory or so. Anyway, pan over somewhat on that circuit, it's very interesting. In fact, what we see here is that one amplifier is used both for recording and playback. That has everything to do with the quite complicated switch here, that you can set into two positions. One is record and one is playback. More or less all to tell, we see here all the old DIN plugs. German industry norm in those days here. Here the oscillator, the paper is damaged, but perhaps you can get an idea. The switch, everything about the switch, etc. So, pen over somewhat. Thanks for watching. Old school technology, very interesting. And very durable. That's important. and I made this switch myself by using a thread here, a bolt and a nut that could move that record playback switch.